Hello everyone! In previous videos I've discussed the interference of light waves, but visible light just covers a tiny part of the electromagnetic spectrum, which runs from radio waves that can have a wavelength of kilometers to gamma rays that have a wavelength much smaller than the nucleus of an atom. And even though these types of radiation behave quite differently, they all have one thing in common: they are just alternating electromagnetic fields. So in this video I want to do a few experiments with radio waves and visible light and look at some similarities and differences. And in the second half of this video I'll show you a few simple optical experiments that have mind-boggling implications, which I hope will forever change the way you look at photons. But first, let's start out with an experiment that demonstrates the interference of radio waves. For this I'm going to use a high-frequency signal generator connected to either one or two antennas and place these in my backyard. And we're going to take a look at the signal strength at various locations in the yard using a radio receiver. The signal generator that I have can generate electromagnetic radiation with frequencies ranging from 9 kHz all the way up to 2 GHz. And you can set the output power to anywhere between plus 20 dBm to minus 136 dBm. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the dBm scale, I made this table showing how the dBm scale relates to the output power in watts. 0 dBm is equivalent to 1 milliwatt, and every 10 dBm change means a tenfold change in power. And this transmitter can output from 100 milliwatt max to about 25 attowatts. By the way, if you know the sensitivity of your receiver and you know the efficiencies of your antennas and cables, etc., you can also estimate the reception range for a certain power output level of the transmitter. And as you can see, to cover my backyard, which is only about 13 meters deep, a power level of minus 40 or even minus 50 dBm should be sufficient. So basically, a transmission power in the nanowatt range. For the interference experiment, I decided to use a frequency of approximately 400 MHz, which is equivalent to the wavelength of 75 centimeters. The choice for this wavelength is actually based on convenience. It's one arm's length, which means that I can just move my arm to navigate between the high and the low intensity values in an interference pattern. So I looked up the closest vacant frequency next to 400 MHz to do this experiment. The antennas I built for this are actually a quarter of a wavelength long, which is 18 centimeters. They are made from a thin copper wire that is connected to a BNC connector and protected with some shrink tube. For the stands, I used pieces of aluminum profile that are electrically connected to ground. And to demonstrate interference, I placed the two antennas about 5 meters apart, which is equivalent to about 6.5 wavelengths. Now, I just want to point out one more detail about the transmitter itself. You can modulate the high frequency carrier wave using a second signal. For example, you can modulate the amplitude of the carrier frequency, a technique generally referred to as AM radio. Or you can use frequency modulation, in which case the signal is used to slightly change the frequency of the carrier wave. And the signal generator can do this for you. It can internally modulate the carrier using a frequency of either 400 Hz or 1 kHz in AM or FM mode. And we will modulate the signal because we can then more easily hear it on the receiver. By the way, for the experiment I used AM modulation because, contrary to FM, you have a constant carrier frequency, which makes observing interference more easy. Of course, using tone signals is a bit boring, so to totally rock this experiment, you can alternatively use an external audio source to modulate the signal. In that case, you just need a few more things: a cap, a pair of sunglasses, an audio signal source, and a cable to connect it to the external modulation input. Maybe not. Here I connected one antenna and set the transmission level to minus 40 dBm, which is more than sufficient to cover the whole backyard. And as you can see, when I move away from the antenna, the signal can clearly be received everywhere in the garden. The only thing is that as I move away from the antenna, the signal becomes slightly lower. Now, if I connect a second antenna and repeat the experiment, we observe that the intensity of the radiation varies quite a bit when moving around the yard. In fact, there's these dead spots where there seems to be no signal at all. And these areas are actually tiny. If I just move the radio a few centimeters away from such a spot, we receive the signal again. Now, this phenomenon is caused by interference of the radio waves. Basically, the dead spots are places where the radio waves from the two antennas cancel each other out exactly, because there is a phase difference of half a wavelength between the two antenna signals. And if, for example, I rotate one of the two antennas by 180 degrees, we observe that the signal goes from very low to a high value, because then the radio waves are not cancelling each other out anymore, but are suddenly interfering constructively, because they are in phase again. So, from the classical point of view, where electromagnetic waves are just waves, this experiment is actually pretty straightforward. In fact, it's tempting to name it the double antenna experiment, as sort of a radio wave equivalent of the optical double slit experiment. But when you consider it quantum mechanically, there is actually a very essential difference between the two. Here we're not dealing with single photon interference, as is the case in the double slit experiment. No, even though the signal from both antennas is coherent and it has a constant phase difference, both antennas emit their own individual photons. And this means that we have two unique sources instead of just one, as is the case in the standard double slit experiment. And this means that, in turn, what we're observing is the effect of interference between photons. So, two-photon interference. And as I will show later in this video, demonstrating two-photon interference with visible light is not so easy. Now, radio waves are also quantized, just like visible light is, only in much finer steps. So here's a comparison of the wavelength and the energy properties of a radio wave compared to those of a green laser. Now, if we quickly look at the wavelength as a property here, we see that the wavelength of the radio signal is 5.7 million times larger than that of the green photon. On the other hand, individual green photons contain an energy that is 5.7 million times higher than that of the radio photons. So this makes the quantization steps in radio waves extremely small. And for this reason, radio waves basically behave like classical waves, and they do generally not display any noticeable quantization. And the reason why we can observe two-photon interference with radio waves is that their wavelength is huge compared to that of light. Also, there are so many photons present at any time that their electric fields can effectively overlap and apparently interact. And in fact, if we were to go down to energy levels where this is not the case anymore, we should not be able to detect interference between the two antennas. But unfortunately, detecting radio waves at single photon level is not something that I can do with my receiver. But what I can do is build sort of a visible light equivalent of the two transmitter situation and see if somehow I can observe two photon interference similar to that seen in radio waves. For this, I built a modified version of the double slit experiment. Instead of taking one laser and two slits, I used two lasers, each pointing at one particular slit. And now we have the situation that the two individual slits emit their own individual photons. And these photons cannot self-interfere because they originate from one particular source or slit. In the experiment, the slits are very close together, about 0.2 millimeters. Also, they're very narrow, around 5 microns. And to make each beam only reach one of the two slits, I added knife edges to the optical paths to limit the spatial position of the beams. Now, this does not give a perfect separation because of the small amount of diffraction occurring at these edges, but it actually works well enough to do the experiment. So, now that we've made two tiny light sources that emit individual photons, we can observe the spatial intensity distribution on the other side of the slits using a microscope. And I've used this trick in a few previous videos. For those of you who did not see these and want to know more, I'll post links in the description. Basically, what you do is you use a microscope with a very shallow focal depth and this allows you to observe what's going on in a very thin slice of the total interference pattern developing behind the slits. And the interference can then be studied using a camera and a PC, both visually as well as by doing measurements on the intensity variations. So what are the different outcomes of this experiment? In the case we're not observing effects of interference, the intensity pattern will be the pure sum of the intensity patterns generated by the two individual slits. So in that case, the total integrated intensity observed in the overlap area will be the sum of the two individual intensity curves. Now, another option is that we do observe interference, like we've seen with the radio waves. In that case, the total integrated intensity under the interference peaks will be equal to half of the sum of the two curves. Now, there is one important issue here with this setup. Unlike in the case of the two radio antennas, we do not have two coherent sources. The two semiconductor lasers that I use have a slightly different frequency, and this frequency can vary quickly in time. And as is shown in this example, small differences of even one part per million will lead to interference shifts that are so fast that you could not pick them up with your eyes or with a camera. So we will not observe a distinct interference pattern consisting of peaks and valleys. But luckily, we can still establish whether there is net interference. And we can do this by measuring the total average intensity. So if you observe that the net intensities of the individual slit patterns nicely add up in the interference pattern, there is no interference between the two slits. On the other hand, if we observe that the average signal is equal to half of the sum of the individual peaks, we know that there is interference. And we may even observe something in between, where there is some degree of two-photon interference. So, what do you think we'll observe? Now, while you think about this, I'll show you around the actual setup. It's about 7 by 10 centimeters, and as you can see, it's made of simple pieces of aluminum L-profile. The setup is mounted on an adjustable stand next to the inspection microscope. So here we have the two laser diodes, and the beams are collimated using these two lenses, and in this small plate here, the two slits are located. By the way, these are the two knife edges that limit the beam range of each laser to only one single slit. Let's take a look at the interference pattern behind the slits. So here we see the situation where the two slits are in focus of the microscope, and if we move our field of focus more to the back, we will see that the light from the two slits meets up here in the center. And here you have the result of the experiment. In the case of these two lasers, the two intensities add up exactly. And this means that there is no or very little observable two-photon interference, even with these lasers operating at almost their maximum brightness. Now, it is not proving that two-photon interference is not possible in photons. I think it is. You just need a much higher laser intensity and preferably two completely coherent laser sources in order to demonstrate it. So after this initial experiment, I decided to change the setup a bit, as is shown in this picture. I removed one of the lasers and kept the optical path to the first slit intact. And then I added the beam splitter, which led 50% of the beam to a mirror. And in this way I created a separate path that only projects its light on the second slit. So now we have the situation that light of a common source is reaching the two slits along two paths that have a different length. So what do you think we'll observe in this case? Interference or no interference? Now the answer is, in this case, we clearly observe interference. And the reason why we observe this nice interference pattern is because the light of both slits is now coherent. By the way, let me show you something really cool. If I close one of these paths, you see that the interference immediately disappears. But surely, what we observe here cannot be single photon interference, right? After all, one of the paths leading to the area of interference is about 40 millimeters longer. And how can it be that a single photon somehow splits up into two completely different paths and still ends up interfering in an area much smaller than the difference in the distance between the two paths? Well, there's only one way to find out if this is really single photon interference. and that is to go down to single photon intensity levels. So what I did was make sure that there's just one photon in the beam at any time. And this is fairly simple. I just reduced the intensity of the beam by 6 or 7 orders of magnitude, first by lowering the laser intensity and then by adding gray filters to the beam. Now, in order to see any signal in this case, I also needed to crank up the gain level of the sensor to about 50 times the normal level. And here is the result. We unmistakably observe interference. Now, the intensity plot looks a bit different from the plots made at higher intensity, and that is mainly because at these very high gain levels, the sensitivity of the CMOS sensor becomes very nonlinear, basically discards the low intensity values. But apart from this, there is no mistake possible. We observe single photon interference even with the path difference present. Now, I've been thinking really hard about how to explain this. And the only thing that I could come up with is that we are not approaching the result of this experiment from the right perspective. So consider this. From the human perspective, time and travel distance are two very real parameters. We observe photons that are traveling with the speed of light because the photons present themselves to us at a specific distance and a specific time after their creation. But as a thought experiment, let us for a moment approach the result from the perspective of the photon. If we were traveling along with the photon on its path, what would this experiment look like then? Well, the thing is, if you were to travel with the speed of light, you would experience the most extreme form of a phenomenon called time dilation.
What are you waiting for? Let's go.
Go, 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 go! 7 years per hour here.
So you probably know this effect from science fiction movies, where as a rocket approaches the speed of light, inside the rocket, time slows down, as seen by an external observer. Now, time dilation is not some exotic science fiction gimmick. It's very real. In fact, the only reason that navigation systems are as accurate as they are is because GPS satellites compensate for the effects of time dilation. So, when traveling at the speed of a photon, time has actually come to a stop because the value of the time dilation has become infinite. Or maybe we should say, time is absent. For photons, time does not exist, and therefore there is no such thing as a time between emission, absorption, or anything that happens in between, like say reflection, diffraction, or interference. For a photon, everything happens in one single instant. So, viewed from this reference frame, the presence of interference is only dependent on specific spatial states that are allowed for the photon. And in this way, interference is actually completely detached from the entity we humans experience as time. Now, I guess this video might be food for thought for some of you. So if you have remarks or questions, please let me know in the comment section.